All right, folks, you know what time it is. It's time for an ad for Overcast. Overcast is an independent podcast app that embraces the open world of podcasting instead of locking it down. No exclusives, no premium content, no paywalls. Just a great podcast app for everyone. As always, you can get it for free on the App Store. Hey, y'all.
What's up?
We got a podcast. Well, you know that. There's another podcast that we think you as a listener to AirGo might want to know about, and it's called Scene on Radio.
It's a show that dives deep into history to tell stories that explore who we really are as a society and how we got this way.
In their best-known season, Seeing White, the show looks at racism by laying out the invention and evolution of whiteness.
And in their latest, season 4, Scene on Radio retells the story of democracy in the U.S., or lack thereof, showing how anti-democratic forces have always been with us and exploring how we can move toward real democracy. So definitely check that out.
That's Scene on Radio. S-C-E-N-E on Radio.
Let's go back. Let's go back. Let's go back. Let's go back.
Well, hello.
What up?
We are here. This is AirGo. I am Damon.
I'm Kiss.
We are going back. This is another one of our once a month series of going back through the AirGo archives and giving you special conversations that you may have missed, but need not to miss out on.
For our final go back of the year, we have a little bit of a treat for y'all. So AirGo started July 27th, 2015, but the week before the show officially started, Damon and I got on the radio for the first time in Chicago together to just kind of test out our flow, get a feel of what it would feel like to be on the air, play some music, kind of a practice run. And we didn't think we had the audio for that. And then I found it on an external hard drive a couple months ago. And it feels like a really long time ago when you listen back. So we figured as a little treat for this last go back of 2020, from July 2015, the two of us on July 2015, never before heard what we fondly refer to as PrepAirGo. Enjoy. Day and night, day and night. The longest owner seems the free as mine at night. Things are close, some things will never change, never change. The longest owner seems the free as mine at night. At night. What's up? What's up? We back. That was Cuddy on a bootleg internet version. I apologize for that. Of Day and Night. And before that, we had Crystal Waters with Gypsy Woman. Or is it Gypsy Woman with Crystal Waters? I don't know. But some old school house classic raw,
song.
Though.
Yeah, you know, to get the Chicago vibe going and get us cracking. But what's been up, man?
I don't know. It feels good to be back in front of a microphone. We were talking earlier about, you know, one of the things about this noon slot is the edited music.
Oh, man, I hate it. I hate the idea of censorship. I hate the idea of clean. Anti that, but I'm going to follow the rules.
Hey, we'll fall in line when we need to if you give us a microphone and an airway. But I was talking with this DJ. I was telling you over at in Poughkeepsie in New York while I was home. He's a mixed DJ and he does clubs and he does radio. And he said he spent 5 hours a day for 3 years just cutting up all of his songs and making them clean. Doing the little reverse.
Yeah, I don't have the patience for that. So I have to like just Google clean radio version and hope that I get a good result.
I
let the internet do the work for me.
what I used to do on my college show is I would, if it was like a well-known song, I'd pull up the lyrics and then right on the spot where the cursor, I would bring the level down and then bring it right back up.
Yeah, see, when we actually went to the same school, y'all, and when I had my show, I could play cursor music. So I went out of my way to find the most vulgar things I could to sully the Grinnell airwaves. And you know what? Now that I'm sitting here, this is the first time we've had a conversation on the microphones with the headphones. And now that I'm hearing your voice, it sounds like a cup of warm cider, Daniel. You are created for this. The sweetness of and the warmth in your voice.
Hey, we're keeping it grown and sexy on WHBK. So you mentioned that you had a show in Grinnell.
Yes, I did.
What was it that initially brought you to radio?
Being really bored and wanting to do something. So what brought me to radio was wanting to be on the internet. really. So the show that I had was called The Boom Box, and I was trying to start this whole little movement or group called Boom, which stood for Bored Out of Our Minds. So trying to, you know, the idea that we're too talented and we have too much at our hands to not like have fun or to be inactive. So from Boom, I had The Boom Box, and we did a live like Ustream of the show while we were on the radio. Mm-hmm. So trying to like, and it was on a Friday night. So the idea was like, if you are bored and you have nothing to do on a Friday night, rock with us. We got you. And so trying to kind of mix my, you know, experience with different social issues, my love and my opinions of music, and then being, you know, a silly, funny dude, trying to mix all of that and just have something to do while I was at school, something that looked cool, something that sounded fun. So that was really what that was about. So I did that for about 3 semesters till I think they kicked us off because before you were the station head, because we didn't follow enough of the rules and they were mad at us for not responding to emails on time.
But we're growing and mature now. We're going to follow the rules as we need.
Yes, that's why I have you here. That's why I have you here.
Oh, I'm the rules.
You are the rules follower.
Oh no. So you mentioned that you felt like you had too much talent, too much
access
and interest to be not doing anything.
Right.
Before you got to Grinnell, what were you doing that you feel like was fulfilling some of those, like when you're still here and you're not stuck in the middle of a cornfield?
Well, when I was growing up, I had a few passions. First was definitely basketball as a young man, especially in Chicago. We are a basketball city. And then Grinnell kind of stumped that out of me. and then also acting and performing. I grew up kind of doing like different commercials and different modeling, mm-hmm. and like kind of small films and stuff. And then also speaking and discussing like socioeconomic inequality and wealth development and investing for young Black people and trying to make that not sound as boring and complicated as I just explained it and like make it personable. And then besides that, just being fun and being vibrant and like experiencing as much of the world and meeting as many people as possible. Those were my passions growing up. And so since then, this is the interview of Damon, for those who didn't know. We were trying to kick off the talk segment. And so since then, now that I'm back home, I'm connecting more with the city. And now that we are in such a turbulent time, what kind of keeps me grounded is, you know, what might be called activism or, mm-hmm. or social organizing or work with what is like known as the Black Lives Matter movement. That is kind of my new basketball or my new recording studio or my outlet to feel kind of free or like myself to like kind of respond to the times and what's going on.
So you mentioned that kind of label for the movement. This is something that I feel like, I don't know, as the months go on and the fervor stays high and the mobilization continues, that I'm starting to see that be a categorization for the movement or a name for it. And I'm just curious what your thoughts are literally about the label.
About the label. I'm glad you asked that because it's very, very complicated, right? So first things first is like I support it because it worked, right. And because it was productive and because I agree that Black lives do matter, right. And I agree that it is necessary and in some ways radical or to affirm that. And to like stand on that very boldly, but sometimes it feels like too neat of a tag. It feels incomplete. So in some instances, it's cool to say Black Lives Matter, but overall, I think we need to start treating that as an assumption and start making bolder or grander assertions, and also just realize that, you know, that idea. Was about the marketing of it and it was about the public relations. And sometimes when you get caught in the label or what's going to go down in the history books, you know, i.e. the civil rights movement, once you call it something that can be written into a paragraph, you overlook the real people. And so sometimes my issue with Black Lives Matter is that it doesn't actually focus on the Black lives. It becomes more about the hashtag and more about the public imaging of that idea instead of the people who have been tear gassed instead of the people who get harassed by the cops actually on a day to day and not just, you know, march and protest and tweet about it. But I love everybody who march and protest and tweets. So
better than not doing that.
Yeah, no shade at all of those people.
I was just watching last night the new documentary on Nina Simone.
I saw that like 2 nights ago. That joint is dope. That joint is super
incredible.
Dope. What were your thoughts? And how like kind of parallel it is to today, right? Obviously.
Yeah. I mean, she's talking, there's a line in it. I can't remember who it was who said it, but talking about her and, you know, her contemporaries is saying like the participating in a movement like that, it inherently calls for you to sacrifice your time, your relationships, yeah. your, for her, her sanity at times.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's why it's so important to stay focused on the humanity of a movement.
Right, right. Because once it be, yeah, I think that's a very good point. Something that she said.
Some people are only sacrificing and other people aren't. They're just hashtag, like the, not every sacrifice is equal, but people got to, if you're participating, the idea is you should be putting something on the table.
Yeah. And just what kind of I moved me about the documentary, the piece is the history mm-hmm. of, like, we could call it Black liberation work. And what's really at stake, like the thing about Black Lives Matter is that it doesn't always account for the lives, and people die mm-hmm. and people go crazy and people go broke for this. So seeing what she said of, like, she was looking around and she was like one that didn't get assassinated or didn't right. overdose. And it was like 1971, 1972. And she was like, they're like, what happened to the movement? And she's like, they're all gone.
Right.
You know, so many of them either got co-opted, got killed, or were targeted in certain ways. Or as we saw with her story, is the issues of mental health, or how all that work and all of that stress and all of that outward performance can deteriorate you. And seeing, you know, kind of how she unfolded over the last like three decades of her life, that is the story that we don't talk about when it right. comes to like movement work, is that people kind of, you can lose your sanity fighting for what should be yours, or fighting for humanity. And that was really touching and moving to see what the movement has done to people in very real senses, and like seeing her daughter and how she did so much for us as a people, quote unquote, but how that, you know, cost her household and her family and, you know, her well-being.
Yeah.
It was really touching.
I mean, it's kind of a damned if you do, damned if you don't, right? Because if you choose not to fight, or I don't know if you can, but if a person says, you know what, I'm not going to take up this cause with all of me, they still might lose their, they still might have to pay those sacrifices
yeah.
because what they're fighting is so powerful and is built to destroy relationships and sanity.
Yeah.
And then even if you do take it up, you might still lose that.
I mean, or it could cause a different type of insanity, which is like complacency,
right.
or like accepting the myths of our world. So a lot of people kind of like, you know, you don't want to be too harsh, but like sell out and be like, oh, I'm not going to worry about all that marching in the streets. Not for me. I'm going to go get this job. I'm going to go, you know, kiss up to the man, not to be like too cliche,
right.
but that is also an insanity to me, to blindly or with apathy, not see or not, you know, answer to what's like going on right in front of you or going on in your backyard.
Yeah,
I think that's a big issue what happens in Chicago.
Yeah. And the apathy can either be, I'm going to kiss up and I'm going to get that job, or it can be, I'm just going to step out. I'm just not going to participate
yeah,
in any
problem.
Of this. Yeah. I mean, and it can work both from positions of privilege and positions of not privilege, where you say, you know what, screw it. I'm not going to participate in this system at all. Or you say, I'm going to just endorse this system wholeheartedly and get mine and keep moving.
So this is a great segue. Speaking of who we're talking about and, you know, not giving into the system, I think Nina needs to be honored above all, especially mm-hmm. in like the music and arts for her contribution and her fearlessness. So here's a little Nina Simone, Put a Spell on You.
A spell on you, 'cause I'm dandy and I'm your man.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. We sell people inside, keep a disguise. You can't see the eyes, see the evil inside. The better people you find, the people you find, stay people inside.
Yeah, shout out Kwali with Get By. What we played before that? We had Nina Simone with I Put a Spell on You. Much love, Talib Kwali. He actually came to the city last week. He was at the Shrine. I saw him perform. I got to meet him, got to chop it up with him. He was a real nice dude. He kind of, you know, it ties into the conversation we were just having about like the connection between art and activism and him being kind of a current or contemporary example of that. I know he's been spent a lot of time in Ferguson as well. So much love to Talib Kweli. Via Kweli close, like Bethlehem and Nazareth. That's my favorite Mos Def line. But yeah, you got to, we're going to talk about you a little bit in your history, Talib. Actually, it's crossed your path before. You got to interview Talib among a lot of other like kind of legends, right?
So before, actually, the first like overlap, it's actually a degree, a separation. He grew up in Fort Greene in Brooklyn.
True.
I'm from the Bronx.
Okay.
But we have family friends who used to babysit him.
So Talib's like your cousin is what you're saying.
Distant.
Your second cousin. That's how we do it. That's how black people do it. Then.
Yeah,
we
but there's no cookout in the middle. There's no cookout in the middle.
Well, I would have called him my cousin if I was you. But continue. That's your, so he's your cousin. And then.
So I was always like, if I ever get a chance to meet him, I'm going to bring up Eric and Emily. They used to babysit him. And then fast forward to last year when we were still in Iowa, him and Big Crit were opening up for Macklemore in Des Moines at an arena.
Okay, rewind. Talib Kweli and Big Crit had to open up for Macklemore. All right, that's great. That's real hip hop right there.
yeah, it was actually a heck of a show. I will say, like, I think arenas are the worst for concerts.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I think in terms of actually enjoying the music and enjoying the concert.
You're about to endorse Macklemore. Is that what this is? Is that what you're setting up? Is that what
stamp of approval?
Is that what all of this is? All right. As a white man. Nah, I'm just playing. But yeah, talk about the Macklemore experience.
Okay. So imagine in the middle of Iowa, you have 17,000 people there for a hip hop show.
Mm-hmm.
That in and of itself, that's out of the norm. That's not to be expected. And that, like, just the, I mean, for a genre that's and a culture that's gone around the world and has influenced so many people, where you still have these blank spots or very somewhat blank spots, you know, a few hours away from a hotbed like Chicago, like that to me is crazy. Or just the amount of it that gets to folks, you know, where you had these little windows where an album like Get Rich or Die Trying could sell 12 million copies in its first week, but that was the only album that sold in, you know, Dubuque.
Right.
Or so to have an actual room with 17,000 people and then to have Crit and Kweli step out on that stage and do
how were they received?
Not with hostility.
Okay.
They were received with
did people know
skepticism.
Like who it was? I'm saying people don't know who Talib Kweli is?
I think more people knew Crit than knew Kweli.
Okay.
But I think some of that has to do with like how hip hop works regionally. And if you get, yeah, I mean, that's part of it. But if you get to Southern Iowa, that's Missouri basically. And there just aren't that many Southern rappers that have a large scope that crosses geographic boundaries. Now, of course, there are a bunch, but for him, I feel like that was why people locked on to his music a little bit more than Kweli's, even though of course, like true legendary status, which if I was an artist, I would never want to be called a legend. Cause that would mean I'm old, but regardless, it was a good show. And I got a chance to interview Kweli for my show, Racing Boundaries. You can check the podcast on iTunes.
All right. Old school plug.
But yeah, he was a good dude. And you said that you got a chance to meet him too.
Yeah. He was cool. I was actually, shout out to comedian D-Ray Davis. He's like kind of like
funny
an
dude.
Uncle of mine. And so I was hanging out with him and then he introduced. So he was real cool. And I told him like, you know, I also have rapped and I also have been activist. Title, you know what I'm saying? So I told him about the Ferguson connection, everything, and just really was trying to show appreciation and say thank you for being an example. And he was real cool. So speaking of Macklemore,
unfortunately we are.
You know, that kind of plays into the larger like conversation about race and culture that is probably being flamed a little bit in this time and, you know, maybe even appropriation of like this post Iggy Azalea moment that we live in. So I'm not even going to put that pressure on you because I feel you not wanting to even go down that road.
I'm
right
comfortable
now.
Speaking for my people.
You're comfortable speaking for your, no, don't do that. You'll get yourself in a lot of trouble if you speak for your people. I'm going to put a stop to that and actually play the antithesis of Macklemore.
That's it.
Lost my life, my hands to fight. Lost my life, hard times like that. Bad trips like that. Nazareth.
I'm fucked up, homie, you fucked up. But if God got us, then we gon' be alright.
We had Kendrick with All Right. He just dropped visuals for that like yesterday or the day before. That joint was super dope. Like you were saying, while we while the music was playing, it's been a good week for visuals and just like visuals in general. Rihanna dropped the BBHMM, or is it just one M? I don't know. The B Word Better Have My Money video. That joint was decent. It was like a sneak diss at her actual accountant who like,
oh, really?
Like, yeah, like her, it says it. It's like a lot of subtext. Watch it again. But her accountant like almost lost her like $10 million or something.
Wow.
And so it was a video about her getting her revenge on him.
Yeah, I feel like of all the people to be on the bad side of, I just wouldn't want to mess with her.
Nah. She gets things sticky. You know what I'm saying? You could tell like she's not taking no nothing from nobody, at least not these days, you know? So, yeah, I wouldn't want to get on Rihanna's side, bad side either. She had like all of his blood covered over her naked body as she smoked weed. In a crate full of money. Yeah. So I think that's quite a powerful and bold feminist statement. And I actually am not being sarcastic.
Yeah.
Even though I could be. It works both ways.
Yeah. I mean, you get the like the kind of negating phrase, like the Beyonce generation of feminists. Like, yeah, that's like a term that comes up a lot.
Yeah.
But there's impact. I mean, it
might. Nah, it's dope. I mean, she blew up Twitter, and I think.
She's also not in the background of the video covered in blood in a pile of, like, she's not an object in the set, the setting of the video. It's like, that's the person in the foreground.
Yeah. Like, she went there.
Yeah.
She went all the way there.
But we were talking also, you know, coming out of the Kendrick video and some of the unnecessarily just absurd backlash that inherently will come when someone tries to make a statement, you know, about the video or about his performance on BET,
right.
BET Awards, where, why don't you just say like what you were seeing from folks who, it doesn't really matter what they say.
I mean, no, we're going to Fox News. I mean, which is almost like, it's almost ridiculous to talk about anymore. Cause
it's
now
like feels hacky.
They're just saying things ridiculous on purpose. But basically their point was like him fanning flames to the police tensions and him performing on a vandalized police car and him having a line that we hate Popo, he trying to kill his dad in the streets. You know, just making light of the reflection of our realities. They said that he and hip hop in contemporary terms is worse for young Black people than racism in recent years, which is like, we don't even have to entertain.
Yeah, I mean, let's get that
or talk about, you know, respond to that. But that is the backlash.
So forget that second claim. I want to talk about the first one of talking about fanning the flames.
Which I don't think he did. I think the flames are burning.
They're big,
high.
Yeah. Both literally and figuratively on both ends. But it seems like that should, like, I don't think it's in any way making light of it to put it on stage. It's actually like the opposite. It's saying like, this is worth being taken seriously in a conversation around art and
it's healing, right, as well, you know,
to see a reflection of your anger, of your feelings.
Yeah, it's a way to cope for real.
So for you, you know, with all the million things you do, many of them being art and being part of this community where it seems like the overlap between artist, organizer, thinker, community builder is so close. I mean, does that feel like an empowering role to serve those two roles?
I think, yeah, it's definitely empowering and it's exciting. And sometimes it feels like necessity. Like if you can at all, you should make that attempt. If you have the means, you have the ability, and you have the time, like, you know, just capacity to try to create and try to express personally what's going on with you in this messed up world, because other people can relate to that. Or if you can try to reflect the grander social aspects of what's going on in a way that people can understand, like, that is needed every day. And then as you kind of go into that exercise, or at least personally, as I'm, you know, trying to write or perform or talk about these things, or even just be in conversation with them, as it begins to happen in real life, and as there is a public like coordination or response to these things that have been killing us forever for real, it becomes like a sense of obligation or almost a duty to almost like not be hypocritical. And also it is fun and it's life-giving and it's community building. And you know, once you grow up, as many of us have, you know, hearing about the 60s and hearing about what's going on and then being told the lie that like things are all better now and it's all good. You have this like always desire. It's like, it's almost like, you know, Martin Luther King and the Panthers of them are like Michael Jordan or Bugs Bunny. It's like the kid, as a kid, you watch those old videos and you're like, what would I do if that was coming up? Or I wish that I can make that type of change or that type of impact. And so for anybody who has the opportunity to do that today, it is definitely empowering.
And looking at the other folks who you build community with and build movements with here, you know, so many of them also are, you know, artists and writers and poets on their own.
Definitely.
And I just know from being around these different scenes, it seems like specifically poetry here more than in other places is this medium that people keep coming back to and keep coming back to as like an organizing tool, even like at the, you know, the center point of a protest.
Right.
Do you feel like, one, that's effective, and two, are there any ways in which using that art at the center of it is limiting? And people can just kind of snap their fingers at it.
I see what you're saying. One, it's super effective because I think the reason why that is, at least in Chicago, is because like the institutions that are supposed to serve us have almost intentionally failing us. So like when the school system is getting defunded and defunded and defunded, you know, generation after generation, you know, for the last like 10 years, the only real place you have to learn about the world is these like kind of after school programs or these artist led programs. And they are the only place that are really apt to talk about what's going on or to teach you things about the world outside of like, you know, the BS core curriculum type stuff. So as creativity is being pushed out of education, in Chicago, we have places like YCA, we have places like U-Media, and all of these other communities where art is becoming like almost the disguise. It's almost like what the church used to be. Like we're going to talk about God to talk about freedom. Right. But now we're going to like, we're going to talk about metaphors to kind of, if we can't create literally, you know, to kind of create in a, you know, figurative sense, the world that we want. And so from that, it just groomed and birthed a lot of people that had this kind of these dual sensibilities of how to perform and how to, you know, express, but also an understanding of what, you know, safe space means, or understanding of these different, you know, kind of very political things that were taught in a simple and, you know, personable way. And so from that, there's this whole generation of people, you know, Malcolm London, you know, Ethos. And then a lot of the rappers that we have are at least in have an awareness that I think is not in every city and are active. You know, you see a lot of, you know, people like No Name Gypsy or, you know, Chance, not only talking about these things, but also deeply connected with the people
participating in community organizing
that are fighting for this. And it's because they are a product of community organizing, especially as like, you know, the neoliberal, like helping people has to be done through like nonprofits. The only way that people can learn in some of these systems is through kind of art that is pushed outside of the school. And I think that's what like happened in Chicago. And is that limiting? To answer your question, no, because kind of like the Macklemore thing you were saying of like, even if he sucks or even if it's, you know, whitewashing, he brought 17,000 people to listen to hip hop, right? Mm-hmm. So even if it's not as deep or even if it doesn't go anywhere past the snap of this poem, you have now engaged something that is not being talked about anywhere else. And for me, from what I've seen, especially since it's not like always like the bongo drums, like old poetry you think about. When you see people rapping or kind of like footworking in the streets and doing things that you do already, it definitely is like a sugar in the medicine, because kind of standing up can be scary or intimidating. And so making it fun and making it rhythmic and making it creative and making it not boring, I think in Chicago has given, you know, organizing or what we know as the movement an extra oomph for us, you know, more legs.
Yeah, that's interesting. I mean, some of those names that you mentioned are folks that, you know, you'll be hearing in long form discussion on this program over the next few weeks and next few months. And that's kind of part of the idea is in those, you know, there are some of those physical spaces where that work is being done. And then where I think where some of the disconnect happens in terms of representation is that there aren't media spaces or forums where folks still were in the same way that folks have the agency to take ownership and tell their stories and create their art and do their organizing physically, those things kind of get lost in translation because of the consolidation and way that media works. So some of the idea here is using the ideas and the art and the musings of those folks and so many more to kind of create a, if not fully comprehensive, at least a more honest depiction or glimpse of how people are reshaping the culture of the city and of this country.
True. True. That was very well said. I don't even.
So look out for that. That's what's coming in the next few weeks.
You know, hey, AirGo.
Hey.
We are here in the go.
There you go.
Is that intentional?
Oh, yeah. Very intentional.
All right. Catch the pun, people.
I was trying to figure out if we could work the apostrophe into the logo. It just didn't look good.
It didn't work from a design.
But if you want to see what the design looks like and see what the website and get a little bit more of a feel of what we're talking about, AirGoRadio.com.
What?
Live and in effect.
We online, baby.
Hey, we're really.
Mama, I made it. .com. You hear us?
That's if you go to mamaimadeit.com, it will redirect now. But one of the things that we will be doing, like I said, we'll be doing these live long form interviews with some sort of live performance at the end and tapping into some of the different communities across the city and bringing them kind of together to show a little bit more of a tapestry of what's happening here.
That's what's up. That's what's up.
And then
we're getting our WWWs up.
And then every episode will be podcasted on iTunes and on SoundCloud and everything.
That's where you lost me.
Well, I know that piece. But the thing that I think is really exciting to me in taking it from a media space to a physical space is we're going to be doing these mixtapes where we pull the live performances off the air. You know, they'll do them on the air. We'll cut it. We'll curate these live mixtapes that'll come out quarterly. And we'll do a release party with those.
We got a lot going.
Getting some of these folks actually in a room together with y'all. And you'll be able to get your hands on the mixtape, get to meet and hear the performances from some of these folks, and maybe see some great new artists who are doing this work on stage. So stay tuned for a little bit of information about that as the show builds. We'll get started with some interviews in the next couple of weeks. We got a lot coming for you.
Stay in tune, man. We got a lot going on. As you hear, it's going to be big things, summer 2015, going into the fall next year. And, you know, for years to come, we're here.
Yeah.
We got WWWs and .coms. And,
hey, man, I bought that domain name for a year. So we're at least a year.
For a year. I owe you a few dollars on that, too. But we'll handle that off air. But as we're talking about Chicago and all of the artists that, you know, have grown out of this, you know, new time of consciousness, one of my favorite and one of my closest friends, we got John Doe with Ghost.
Who we are. It's written in the stars. Fragile fate. I know that it's too late. I know that who we are is when the stars collide.
That was Have a Nice Day by Your Highness, a raw, super dope collective band here from Chicago, formerly known as She. A lot of them are actually based from St. Louis, so they're not like Chicago. They like to definitely keep that St. Louis-ness about them. And before that, like I said, was John Doe with Ghost off the Solar System Project. Part two of that should be coming out later this year.
Us transplants can bring something to the table too.
Oh, yeah. No, much love to all of the non-natives. I just know some people are very sensitive and don't want to be called Chicagoans if they are from somewhere else. So I just wanted to give them respect, especially since I got so much love for St. Louis.
What's very up? Understandable. Yeah, you've been going back and forth. But we'll talk more about that hopefully next week.
Yeah.
It's been
great, man. I've been calling this, I don't know if you've been catching, I've been trying to be clever. I've been calling this Prep Airgo as we prepare for it, but like
ooh,
prep for the air.
Oh, I like it. Yeah, I like it a lot.
Little pun. So this has been some PrepAirGo, prepares.
If we don't bring you anything else on this show, we will bring you puns. Like we got
that's all we do.
A stack of those that's written on the table here for you. I'm just going, it's like a like Letterman with the note cards. I'm just going through looking for puns.
Oh, man. R.I.P. David Letterman.
He didn't die.
I mean, that's an expression I use. I know he didn't literally die. I know he's alive and well, but like he's gone from his job and his show. But I think we are about to be gone from our show and shut up.
I like to say we're the Letterman of the noon hour in the city of Chicago.
That is very true. Thursdays, Southside, and Internet. There we run it. Up next, we got All Sports. Alan is not around yet, but Mario is here, and I'm sure he's got a lot to talk about.
As always.
There's a lot of NBA movement going around.
Whether you want to hear what he has to say or not, that's a whole other issue.
Oh, no. The draft went cool. Jaleel went to the Sixers, and he didn't seem too happy about that.
First day back. Don't get murdered on the air, Daniel.
And Mario's threatening people. We're about to get out of here.
AirGoRadio.com on Twitter, at AirGoRadio.
Yeah, so I guess I should play one more song as we transition. And since we're gone, I guess I should play that.
All right. Thanks for tuning in, folks. See you next week.
We spy had told who was the only one.
Uh-oh.
But it's too late. It's too late. Keep going.
We strive at home.